house manager, do you have a copy?
Go for house.
Status check on box office and the house.
Box office, please.
And
we have a green light for the house.
Copy that. Thank you. Attention crew. Status check. Lighting?
Lighting is go.
Copy that lighting. Thank you. Audio?
Audio is go.
Copy that audio. Thank you. Talent?
Talent is go.
Copy that talent. Thank you. Standby. Video intro.
Copy.
Okay. How's the half? Video intro go.
The year 2020. On January 1st, we counted down, we blew into horns, we raised our glasses, and we kissed our friends and families to welcome the year ahead, which strived for the perfect vision.
There's supposed to be something grand, something that changed the world for the better.
Well, at first glance, we would all say that this is not the case.
This is not the vision we were prepared for, and it is far from perfect.
However, if we look a little closer, maybe this year was designed to correct our vision.
We missed school, and we realized that we may have taken those sweaty, unair-conditioned Howell High School days for granted.
We understand the need for community and the benefits of socializing casually that we have overlooked until now.
We have gained a much deeper understanding of privilege and have been forced to face disappointments by rising together.
So even though we allow our hair to grow extra long,
our anxieties to sometimes get the best of us,
and our bodies to get the tiniest bit rounder than usual, we are still going to come out of this thriving.
Schools can close.
Social gatherings may end.
People can be quarantined in their homes for months, but art cannot be stopped.
Art always survives. It has emerged through every disease, war, and atrocity that people have ever faced.
This will be no different.
People need to express themselves as much as people need to breathe and drink water.
In fact, it is currently what every household in the country is now relying on. Streaming entertainment.
Expressing creativity.
Looking for an escape, trying a new activity.
People need art more now than ever.
We should feel nothing but pride for the incredible pieces of art that we've managed to produce this year and every year before. FPAC has always been about taking that desire to make change,
to create,
to spread our messages, and make us not just dreamers, but performers.
Over the last few years, we have unlocked more potential than we ever knew we could when we walked into the FPAC audition room.
In the last few years alone, the video program has participated in and won at over 20 different film festivals, including the All-American High School Film Festival, the Central State Film Festival, the Garden State Film Festival, Count Basie Film Festival, and even had a film debut at the Tribeca Film Festival.
The music program has worked almost every show and event at Howell High School, providing audio engineering skills and a production team, including working with Pete Bruno to showcase the Team Miss New Jersey pageant at Howell High School. We've also had opportunities to go to the Audio Engineering Society convention to talk with top-notch people in the music industry.
The dance program has performed multiple shows at Howell High School, self-choreographed countless numbers, danced alongside professionals in New York City, and even self-choreographed and performed for the directors of the movie High Strung.
The acting program has put on countless amount of professional-level evening of scenes and one-act performances. We've learned alongside FPAC alumni working in the industry and fostered the love of theater and of acting. But most importantly, this program has taught countless students, including myself, to learn to not just love themselves in the art, but to love the art in themselves.
With all these incredible accomplishments in mind, we should be happy to know that FPAC is not slowing down.
We are a factory for creation and creativity.
Pioneers in the field of high school performing arts.
If you think that staying indoors is going to keep us down, then you're mistaken.
We use these emotions that you are feeling right now and use it to make art.
The best works of expression have come from times when the world was at its worst.
We are no different.
We are now marked as a class that will be forever remembered in history and one that is destined to change the future.
Thank you for joining us tonight.
We may not be together physically, but please remember,
today, tomorrow, and always, we are Howell.
We are Howell.
We are Howell.
We are Howell. And we, as one family, we are FPAC.
For over 35 years, Howell High School's FPAC program has been producing some of the most talented film, music, acting, and dance students in the state of New Jersey. As being an FPAC student, we feel that many people do not know what FPAC really is. So today, we give you an inside look at this four-year program,
as well as speak to the teachers who teach within this program. What is FPAC Entertainment and Technology's music program?
ET Music and Production is a combination of music theory, music performance, music history, music industry, recording, mixing, editing, engineering, and then live event support, which is production for shows in any of our 7 performance spaces that we have at the school.
What is FPAC Entertainment and Technology's video program?
Entertainment technology, the video production side, we don't turn on your printers, we don't fix your Wi-Fi. It has almost nothing to do with actual computer maintenance. What entertainment technology video is about is storytelling. It's video production. It's creating original works. It's screenwriting. It's photography. It's videography. It's editing. It's the whole process. But no, we can't help you with your Wi-Fi password.
What is FPAC Acting?
FPAC Acting is a program designed to give the students a very realistic view of what it is to work as an actor and to sustain a career as an actor.
What is FPAC Dance?
FPAC Dance is a program that allows students to take dance classes alongside their high school academics. So they get to take ballet, jazz, modern, choreography, silks. They even get to take some voice acting and musical theater classes. They take classes alongside master teachers. They have Q&As with college dance programs. They go to New York City to take classes at professional dance studios, and they're offered multiple performances to showcase their work throughout the year.
And finally, we asked some of our teachers to give us some advice for anyone trying to pursue the arts.
A lot of people seem to think that the arts don't matter as much as the maths and the sciences and things like that. And to those people, I would say, check the science. Check the studies. Arts are just as important psychologically, in some ways, as those core classes.
Say what you're going to do, and then do exactly what you said you were going to do.
Time flies, so just enjoy every moment of it.
Commit to everything with everything you've got. Don't hold back. Don't worry about making a fool of yourself. Just throw yourself into everything as fully as you can.
Copy that. Thank you.
Places. Have a good show, everyone.
Lights and sound. Go. Thank you.
as mild and as meek as a mouse. When I hear a command, I obey. But I know of a spot in my house where no one can stand in my
way. Look at this stuff. Isn't it neat? Wouldn't you think my collection's complete? Wouldn't you think I am the girl who has everything?
I've got gadgets and gizmos aplenty. I've got who's it's and what's it's galore. You want thingamabobs?
I've got 20. But who cares?
No big deal. I want more.
I've been staring at the edge of the water long as I can remember, never really knowing why. I wish I could be the perfect daughter, but I come back to the water no matter how hard I try. Do you want to build a snowman? It doesn't have to be a snowman. Okay.
I know you. I've walked with you once upon a dream. And if I know you, I know what you'll do. You'll love me at once, the way you did once upon a dream.
So wish your heart makes when you're fast asleep. In dreams you will lose your heartaches. Whatever you wish for, you keep. Have faith in your dreams and
someday, when we are wiser, when the world's older, when we have learned, I pray someday we may yet live to live and
look at me. I will never pass for a perfect bride or a perfect daughter. Can it be? I'm not meant to play this part. Now I see that if I were truly to be myself, I would break my family.
Don't fail me now. Courage, don't desert me. Don't turn back now that we're here. People always say life is full of choices. No one ever mentions fear or how the world can seem so vast on this journey to the
window is open, so's that door. I didn't know they did that anymore. Who knew we owned 8,000 salad plates? For years I've roamed these empty halls. Why have a ballroom with no balls? Finally, they're opening up the... What's that word again?
Street. Up where they walk, up where they run, up where they stay all day in the sun, wandering free. Wish I could be
a part of the world. Dazzling place I never knew, but when I'm way up here, it's crystal clear that now I'm in a whole new world with you.
What I'd give to return to the life that I knew lately, and to think I complained of that dull provincial town.
And you'll never hear the wolf cry to the blue corn moon, for whether we are white or copper skinned, we need to sing with all the voices of the mountain.
need to paint with all the colors of the wind.
If the wind must sail the sea stays behind me, one day I'll know how far I'll go.
Let it go, let it go. I am one with the wind and sky. Let it go, let it go. You'll never see me cry. Here I stand, and here I'll stay. Let the storm rage on. Impossible, things are happening every day.
Charles Bloomfield, for violation of New York State Penal Code 120.45, otherwise known as stalking in the fourth degree, I sentence you to 3 months of mandatory court-appointed therapy.
I'm aware that today is October 10th, the day you've been speaking of. Now, I want to make this clear to you, Charlie. You can't contact Rose under any circumstance, okay?
Of course, Doctor.
Nothing is going to happen today. I want you to try and remain calm. You've come so far, Charlie. I don't want to see you regress. You have to continue avoiding contact with Rose Romano. Understood?
Yes.
So, what are the key steps for today?
Remain calm. Do not contact Rose. And remember that today is like every other day. October 10th is like every other day.
Watch where you go, kid. It's gonna be a bad day for you.
For all of us.
Don't you feel it, Dr. Sharon?
What?
The city, it's darker recently. I keep seeing these people watching me. Something is wrong, Doctor, and I think maybe they know too. Hello, is Rose here today?
Oh, you're Charlie? One second, please.
Charlie, please try and listen to me. She was just being friendly to you. You barely know her.
Barely know her? I love her, and if I don't get her out of here, then who will?
You're right.
Right about what? What am I right about?
You again? Rose isn't here. Get lost. Are you deaf? Beat it before I call the cops.
Thanks for dining with us. Come back soon.
You're catastrophizing, Charlie. Your brain took a small occurrence and spiraled into believing something completely irrational. You're letting paranoia control you. Besides, the connection to Rose would lead me to believe this date would have positive connotations.
You're drawing false conclusions. I know something is going to happen, not just to me, to everyone. It's simply a matter of getting Rose out of here before that happens.
Hey, pretty boy. $10, 10 cents, that's all I need. Come on.
Now, if you really did understand me, you see what I'm seeing, you'd already be gone.
Oh my God, it's you from the restaurant.
Well, this is a peculiar place to bump into you again. Charlie, by the way.
Charlie? How do you know where I live? Did you follow me? You need to leave! Get out of here right now! I'll call the cops!
Rose, it's Charlie.
Don't touch me!
I know what you're thinking, but please, just... We're both in danger. Rose! I just need to get her out of the city. There's too many people here, the ones that are watching me. Whatever's happening, it's concentrated here.
Rose, please just listen. I'm not gonna hurt you. I never would. I just need to get you away from here. You just have to trust me.
Get away from me. Pretend you didn't see me and just walk away.
Rose.
You barely even know me.
You're not listening. We are in danger.
Get away from me. I mean it.
Rose, something bad is about to happen if we don't...
I was on the front lines as COVID came into New York. And when half of my patients became COVID patients, I found myself crying. A lot. I would sit in the shower and I would just cry and cry. And I would sit on the train and tears would fill my eyes. I would be on the phone at work, trying to explain to someone with no medical background that I couldn't find PPE for whatever reason, and I would just have to stop talking for a second so that the lump in my throat would go away. I was scared for the patients and their families. I was scared for my co-residents. I was scared that my husband would catch it from me. Best case scenario, healthcare workers suffer from adjustment disorder. Worst case scenario, we'll have PTSD.
I think about my sickest patients at night. I wonder if they'll still be alive when I come into work the next day. Pray for them. Some nights I dream COVID nightmares all night. I'm scared of getting it myself. I'm scared of having to treat a friend or a colleague. I'm scared that this will continue to overrun our healthcare system and that we might have to make choices that no one should have to make. I try to keep myself focused on the next patient, the next hour, and sometimes the next minute. Try to remind myself that this is not the end of the story.
There is a lot of learning in treating COVID-19 patients. How careful we have to be with them, not too close or touching the patient unnecessarily, how precisely we have to check their vitals, how we need to talk to them. We need to avoid hurting them with our words or our actions. There were 8 COVID-19 patients in the ward, and we're all asymptomatic without any comorbidities. We just needed to check their vitals, take their history, find out who came in contact with them. No one even had fever. Their ages were from 22 to 90 years old. They wanted to gossip among themselves.
There aren't enough female doctors and specialists in Afghanistan. Afghans are so conservative, they don't want male doctors to check their women. Women are losing their lives. That is why I decided to become a midwife. I save moms' lives. When the COVID-19 center was established, I applied for a job. I worked 12 hours per day. Many people, including pregnant women, came for tests. Sometimes it's hard to handle, but it is a crisis and people must be kind. A few days ago, a pregnant woman with symptoms came to the center. Her husband said that no men were allowed to check on her, even if she died. We put the woman in isolation. My coworker and I went to check her. She was panicking. She started screaming and fainted. For a moment, I lost myself. But very soon, I realized I needed to stay strong and help her. We took her blood and checked her blood pressure. When she gained consciousness, she started crying and said she wanted to go home. I told her, the virus doesn't kill everyone and it isn't a thing to be ashamed of. Anyone can get it. It was hard to convince her, but we made it.
Darling, darling, oh, turn the lights back on now. Watching, watching as the credits all roll down. And crying, crying, you know we're playing to a full house. House. No heroes, villains, one to blame. While wilted roses fill the stage and the thrill. The thrill is gone. Our debut was a masterpiece, but in the end, for you and me, hold this show, it can't go on. We used to have it all, but now's our curtain call. So hold for the applause. Oh, 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 oh. And wave out to take our final bow. Oh, it's our time to go. But at least we stole the show. 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 Darling, darling, you know that we are sold out. Kisses fading, but the band plays on now. We're crying, crying, so let the velvet roll down. Down. No heroes, villains, one to blame. While wilted roses fill the stage and the thrill. The thrill is gone. Our debut was a masterpiece. Our lines we read so perfectly. But this show, it can't go on. Darling, darling, you know that we are sold out. Kisses fading, but the band plays on now. We're crying, crying, so let the velvet roll down. Down. No heroes, villains, one to blame. While wilted roses fill the stage. And the thrill is gone. Our debut was a masterpiece. Our lines we read so perfectly. But this show, it can't go on.
We stole the show.
for the applause. Wave out to the crowd, take our final bow. This our time to go, but at least we stole the show.
did you?
Oh, must have blown a fuse or something. I'll go get the flashlights.
Do we have a generator? No. I just have to flip the switch on the circuit breaker. Do we know where that is? No, you have to ask your father. I have no idea.
Here you go, huh?
Wait, I didn't get one.
Well, you only got two.
So I don't get one?
Well, I gotta fix the circuit breaker box.
About that, do you know where it is?
No, I don't. So, the circuit breaker's usually in the garage or the basement. So, let's just split up and look for it. But wait, there's a problem.
What's that?
If it were to be in the basement, it would likely be in the small closet under the stairs. Maybe me and Mom could fit in there.
No way, I'm not going in there. There's spider webs.
Well, you want to go on without power for God knows how long? No Wi-Fi, no Netflix, no Facebook.
No Facebook.
No Facebook.
Hannah, you have to do this. We can't live like this. Okay, I'll try.
All right, Hannah, you go down in the basement. I'll go in the garage, and Mom, you go check upstairs.
I found it! Which one do I switch?
Just try one!
It's not working!
Yo, Adam, we've all night until Mom and Dad get home. What do you want to do with all this time?
Something fun?
Yeah, you're right. Do you want to play Xbox?
Okay.
Hello, lovely parents.
Listen, the party was canceled. We will be home in 10 minutes. I expect my room to be squeaky clean. Got it?
Yeah, got it. All right, bye. Adam, we have to go now. No time to explain. We gotta go. Hurry up. All right, Adam, hide all those clothes underneath the blankets. You can't let them see them. Hide them, quick. You don't have much time. Hurry up. All of them. Let's go. Stay clean, my man. Gotta stay clean.
How'd it go, boys?
When I told her what you'd done, she said, "You have married an Icarus. He has flown too close to the sun. Don't take another step in my direction. I can't be trusted around you. Don't think you can talk your way into my arms, into my arms.
I'm burning the letters you wrote to me. You could stand over there if you want. I don't know who you are. I have so much to learn. I'm rereading your letters and watching them burn.
I'm watching them burn. You published the letters she wrote to you. You told the whole world how you brought this girl into our bed. In clearing your name, you have ruined our part of some scheme.
You're an enemy whisper.
So you have to scream. I know about whispers.
I see how you look at my sister.
Don't. I'm not naive.
I have some women around you.
Don't
think I don't see how they
fall for your charms. All your charms. You broke her heart. You have thrown it all away. Stand back, watch it burn. Just watch it all burn. And when the time comes,
explain to the children the pain and embarrassment
you put their mother through.
When will you learn
that they
I asked to be reassigned to the ER because we're no longer doing elective procedures at the outpatient department where I work full time. And with my 15 years of previous ER experience, I knew my colleagues could use the help. In all my years of nursing, I have dealt with an extraordinary number of people dying. To watch COVID-19 patients die alone without their loved ones is something else entirely.
During this pandemic, I've been on the ambulance 5 days a week near Baltimore. The work here is stressful, but what impresses me is how grateful I am to be serving my community during this unprecedented time of need. In my younger patients, the fear is palpable. One 19-year-old security guard had shortness of breath for 2 days, and then when driving home from work, abruptly couldn't breathe. He pulled over to the side of the highway and called 911. "Am I going to die?" he whispered. Every molecule in my body wanted to tell him that he was going to be all right, but I didn't know that. "We're a team," I replied, "working together to ensure that you have the best possible health care." Daughters old enough to be retirees sobbed as I assisted their mothers onto the stretcher. "I don't want her to go to the hospital because I'm scared she'll get the virus. It is a common concern. I love you, Mom," I hear repeatedly muttered with last embraces before I take their beloved family members from their home to an inaccessible emergency department. One 93-year-old patient kept on asking me en route to the hospital, "When am I going to see my daughter again?" I rubbed her shoulder and offered, "When you get out of the hospital."
My patients are watching the news, seeing how many people are dying, knowing they're positive. They ask me if they're going to die. I tell them we are all trying our absolute best to get them back home to their loved ones. I chose a career in healthcare, specifically critical care, because I wanted to help people in their most vulnerable and dire time of need. I put my faith in God and take precautions by properly donning, removing, and disinfecting my personal protection equipment. But in the back of my mind, I can't help but wonder how the risk of infection increases by constant exposure.
We travel from state to state, hospital to hospital, to help ERs that are understaffed. It means I have to learn to navigate a new hospital and work with new coworkers ever so many weeks. We are understaffed and undersupplied for the COVID-19 crisis, but we will still fight for our patients' lives and well-beings, even at our own risk. We spent hours in a room lined with plastic sheets, a makeshift negative pressure unit in the ER, where we can fit up to 9 beds at a time. You wouldn't believe how tight the corridors can be sometimes. I spent all shifts in some form of protective gear, to the point that my skin will sometimes be rubbed raw by it.
I picked up a patient from the emergency department who was deteriorating quickly. It was a mad dash to intubate him. We had to prep medication, secure a ventilator, and get the doctor and respiratory therapist in the room. The doctor came in swiftly and was ready to go. I realized that we had barely said a word to this patient since we met him. I untangled the TV remote, brought it to the patient, and asked him if there was any specific music he would like to listen to before we intubated him and while he was sedated. His face lit up a little bit, as much as it could. He smiled and asked, "Do you have Pink Floyd?" I immediately cried, found some Pink Floyd, and checked on him every day after to make sure his music was playing. Every time I tell that story or even think of Pink Floyd, I weep. Fortunately, the patient was weaned off the ventilator and transferred to a regular floor. He might never remember that moment, but I know I will for the rest of my life.
I get up, I get down, and I'm jumping around, and the rumpus and ruckus are comfortable now. Been a hell of a ride, but I'm thinking it's time to grow. So I got an apartment across from the park, put quinoa in my fridge, still I'm not feeling great. Been a hell of a ride, but I'm thinking it's time to go.
Here we go.
So put your best face on, everybody pretend you know this song. Everybody come hang, let's go out. Feel like I'm gonna puke, cause my taxes are due. Do my password begin with a 1 or a 2? Been a hell of a ride, but I'm thinking it's time to grow.
Metronome.
Man, I'm up to something. Ooty-la-dee-do, thank you all for coming. I hope you like the show, cause it's on a budget. So ooty-la-dee-do, yeah, come on, here we go, yeah, come on.
Here we go.
So put your best face on, everybody pretend you know this song. Everybody come hang, let's go out. Go out with the bang.
I said it before and I'll say it again. Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop and look around once in a while. You could miss it.
What is so dangerous about a character like Ferris Bueller is he gives good kids bad ideas.
Why should he get to skip school when everybody else has to go?
Syphilitic meningitis.
He never gets caught.
This guy in my biology class said that if Ferris dies, he's giving his eyes to Stevie Wonder.
Well, he's very popular, Ed.
I recall Central Park in fall.
Ferris Bueller, do you know him?
Yeah, he's getting me out of summer school.
They think he's a righteous dude.
Think he'll be alive this weekend?
I can see him denying popular beliefs, setting off on some impossible mission.
He jeopardizes my ability to effectively govern this student body.
He does whatever he wants.
You know, as long as I've known him, everything works for him.
Whenever he wants.
He's very cool.
And he never gets nailed.
Ferris can do anything.
Oh, he's such a sweetie.
Wake up and smell the coffee, Mrs. Bueller. It's a fool's paradise. He is just leading you down the primrose path. Matthew Broderick.
Bueller. Ferris Bueller.
Ferris Bueller's day off. Because life is too beautiful a thing to waste.
I'm Taylor. Nice to meet you. I'm so glad that I met you. We've grown so close in such a quick time.
18-year-old Taylor White has been missing for 3 weeks now. If you have any information on her whereabouts, please contact the number that appears on the screen.
I love you too. Is everything okay? I need some space, please. I can't do this anymore. You seem to be too obsessed with me to the point that I'm afraid of you. This is the last you'll hear from me. Goodbye. Why are you at my house? Please get away from me. Don't touch me! You're sick.
What I'm most worried about is the mental health crisis that is beginning. The amount of anxiety and depression I'm seeing in my patients is heartbreaking. They've lost their jobs and their health insurance with no access to support network. Grandparents are not able to see their children and their grandchildren. People are not going to church or social clubs. I'm fearful that this wave of mental health challenges will be on par with the horrors of the virus itself. I've gone through all the stages of grief. I'm just numb now. I feel let down by the government and those that were supposed to protect me with masks, gowns, PPE. I'm just tired. Sometimes I just want out.
You know, I've watched 30-year-olds with no other medical history die from this virus. When I hear patients in distress, I can't run to them fast enough. You know, we're already short on supplies and staff, and I'm always caring for at least 10 COVID patients. They can't see their families, so what I'm trying to do is provide them with some sort of sense of comfort. I want to be there for them. You know, I really want to be strong, but sometimes I just want to break down. This is hell.
When people are experiencing their worst moments, I feel good knowing that once I arrive, I can make a difference.
We did choose this job. But we are human, and people have their limits. Some of us are just getting by, some of us are doing fine. And some of us are just not okay. There was a moment in the beginning of this when I told my 7-year-old son that I loved him and I would see him later. I walked out the door with a few personal belongings, a few clean uniforms. Did I want to quit and stay home? Yes. The call skyrocketed. I have pleaded with patients to hold on while transporting them. I have told them to be strong while they're wheeled into a room full of doctors and nurses waiting to intubate them. I feel horrible for having to tell family members that they cannot come in with their loved ones. There have been many times these past few months where I have broken down and cried to my work partner. Sometimes I just hug her with no words needed. I often ask her when will this end.
As the first hospital in the country with cases of community spread COVID-19 and fatalities, we were hit hard and ramped up fast. We converted half of the department to an isolation unit for positive and potential or suspected cases of COVID-19. Intense means different things at different times. Every day there is something that shakes you. After 27 years in nursing, it was very hard to be surprised. Not anymore. One evening, a large family came into the waiting room. The family patriarch was upstairs dying. I had my tech escort two family members to the unit, the limit of what we could allow for the end-of-life care due to safety concerns. One of the younger family members came to ask me a question and started to break down. I couldn't keep a 6-foot distance. I took her in my arms and did what I've always done as a nurse. I met her need in the only way I could. I gave her a safe place to weep, to catch her breath, to feel seen and understood. Sometimes intense is the critical clinical care we provide. And sometimes it is the intensely personal support when a patient or a loved one reaches their breaking point.
I have been attracted to the medical profession for as long as I can remember. It is in my nature to care for others and ensure that they're healthy, whether it be mentally or physically. There's not a lot of other jobs that kind of ensure that kind of criteria, so I feel like I'm in the right place. I am currently working with the Doctors Without Borders COVID-19 team in Buera in the southwest region of Cameroon. And during the first weeks of the outbreak, at least in my country, my sister developed the symptoms of COVID-19. She called every night to complain about a severe headache, which I thought was related to her wearing glasses, ironically. And, well, she cried on the phone for days, and she added that she'd lost her sense of smell and her taste, and traveling was impossible. Her fear of going to the treatment center was another stress, but I helped in managing her case from afar, and she recovered. I'm scared this pandemic isn't going to be controlled soon. There's a high risk to bear this for a longer time than we wish, but my will to help will not change a dime.
Divorced.
Beheaded.
Died.
Divorced.
Beheaded.
Survived.
And tonight, we are...
Survived, and just for you tonight,
we're divorced, beheaded, live.
Welcome to the show today.
report. Every tune a row has its thorns, and you're gonna see them live in consort.
Divorced,
beheaded, died.
Divorced,
beheaded,
survived.
And just for you tonight, we're divorced, beheaded, lied. Welcome to the show, to the history mix. Switching up the flow as we add the prefix. Everybody knows that we used to be six wives. Dancing to the beat till the break of day one. So we're gonna start again like it's the Renaissance. Everybody knows that we used to be six wives.
Married 24 years, I'm a paragon of royalty. My loyalty is to the Vatican, so if you try to dump me, you won't try that again.
I'm that Berlin girl, and I'm up next. See, I broke England from the church. Yeah, I'm that sexy. Why did I lose my head? Well, my sleeves may be green, but my lipstick's red.
James Seymour, the only one he truly loved.
Rude.
When my son was newly born, I died. But I'm not all I seem, or am I? Stick around and you'll suddenly see more.
Ich bin Anna of Cleves.
Yeah.
When he saw my portrait, he was like,
yeah.
But I didn't look as good as I did in my pic.
Funny how we all discussed that, but never Henry Little.
Pick up your ears, I'm Kathryn, who lost her head.
Beheaded.
For my promiscuity outside of wed. Lock up your husbands, lock up your sons. K. Howard is here, and the fun's begun.
Survived.
Back down on the final wife. I saw him at the end of his life. I'm a survivor, Kathryn Parr. Bet you wanna know how I got this far. I said I bet you wanna know how I got this far.
Do you wanna know how we got this far?
2 a.m. love, gotta keep it down. Don't wait around for a signal now. Give me some verb, I ain't talking now. You wanna ride in the six, you wanna down in the six. But when I lean for the kiss, you said I'll probably send you some pics. And I'm like, hell nah, been waiting too long. Hell nah, I want that cruel love. Hell nah, been waiting too long. Hell nah, I want that cruel love. Body on my, losing all my innocence. Yeah, body on my, finding all my innocence. Yeah, body on my, losing all my innocence. Yeah, body on my, finding all my innocence. Yeah, body on my, losing all my innocence. Yeah, body on my.
While wilted roses fill the stage, and the thrill is gone. Our debut was a masterpiece, but in the end, for you and me, hold this show, it can't go on. We used to have it all, but now's our curtain call. So hold for the applause, oh, 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 oh. And wave out to the crowd. Take our final bow. Oh, it's our time to go. But at least we stole the show. At least we stole the show. At least we stole the show. At least we stole the show.
show. At least we stole the show.
Hidden, tucked between a chem lab and math, sits a secret refuge, a pocket dimension full of crumbs, a mouse hole, security blanket, safety in a chaotic place, secrets whispered, locked away. Give me your tired, hungry, poor, or if you just need to pee. Meet up or hook up, desperately try to look up, history test answers, your crush's homework key, how to tell if they like you, but WikiHow doesn't hold, the myths, passed on legends that linger among the stalls, ancient hieroglyphics scratched in with a broken pencil, girls trying to immortalize, to be heard, to be seen. Invisible girls pass through here. If you listen close, you can hear them breathe. Ghosts of girls, both dead and alive, fix their hair in the mirror, trying to disappear, hoping that this time when they look up, they'll be gone, but they never will be. Lost souls cannot escape through the clogged up air vents, clogged with vapor, nicotine, with sweat and breath and chewed up gum. Out of order stalls or toilets too gross to even touch the handle. Clog up the lines, clog up the toilets, clogged with the smell of bodies. Bodies that came from gym that didn't feel like changing. Too depressed to take a shower, too much to do, to care, for herself or for anything. This is where that smell lives. The smell of bubblegum. Pink lipstick reapplied. She complains about the dress code, audible groan that spans decades can be heard through the walls. The bathroom groans with you, shorts too short, tank tops, cleavage to warrant her crying about him, what he did, to warrant what he did. The he is interchangeable, the bathroom knows, there are many hymns that she comes here to escape. She comes to rant about, she comes to sob about, she comes to heal, to hurt, to vague about online, to text about. It's what she knows. She hates her nose, her stomach, thighs, voice, teeth, everything. The girl's bathroom has a funhouse mirror, tilted and curved, concave and convex, but when you look to the left, she looks so beautiful. Toilet paper passed, tampons passed, secrets, tissues, tight hugs passed, you skipped second period because you got your period, too messy or too late or not at all. You scrunch up toilet paper because you forgot a pad, she ties a sweatshirt around her waist. Carved conversations, giggles move from stall to stall, smiles spread like infections. I like your hair, saved her life. I like yours too, saved hers. They don't know each other's names. Most don't, but that's okay. We're all just she in an it hiding from a he, or an it or another she or a me or them in a place to escape the College Board breathing down our necks. In the bathroom, it goes away. You leave with damp hands and a long sigh. She returns back to life, but the bathroom still remains. It sits behind her in the C wing upstairs, the one where the sunlight shines perfectly from the window, the one where we take photo shoots, the one where we meet up. Not the D wing, wrong one. It's okay, I'll meet you next period. The one where the sign-in teacher doesn't care, the one where everyone doesn't care if you're there to escape or just to pee, because no matter what, they'll think of a compliment, because no matter what, it will be there. Fluorescent lights and speckled stalls. Just get a pass, sign in, and wash your hands before you leave.
I love when the sun paints a golden hue on everything before it disappears into the obsidian night. Its rays are like an artist's brush, delicately covering the world's canvas with luminosity. When the glow eventually fades, and the stars barely light up the sky, it's like an artist shutting off the studio lights after a long day's work. Temporarily departed, but soon to return to paint the canvas with incandescent lights once again.
Thank you.
just to say that I wanna walk the beach at sunrise, drive on down the coastline, only worrying about where we'll go next. How I wanna feel the breeze through my hair, let's go off the grid to nowhere, and I won't be sad.
Well, I'm just finishing up nursing school, but graduation's been replaced with a virtual ceremony and the licensure exam's been rescheduled. I will still be a nurse, but right now I am happy I am fighting this pandemic as a nursing aide. Well, I can still make a difference. This crisis has made us hyper-focused on hygiene and disciplined about protection. I have been mindful with every move I make during my shift. A lot of people are on edge and the anxiety is at a new level. We do everything in our power to protect ourselves, our colleagues, and our patients, but there's always that fear of bringing this home. The worst thing a nurse can think about is being responsible for someone else's illness.
It kills me when I hear, well, that's what they signed up for. I never took a pandemic nursing class. The biggest change would have to be worrying about myself, going into a patient's room and flinching every time they cough, feeling guilty that you even flinched at all, even though we are covered head to toe, guilty that they can't see my face or hear my voice muffling under my mask and face shield, guilty that I can't see them. Then leaving them in a room alone. The guilt has no beginning or end.
I want my patients and their families to feel really cared for. I ask family if their loved ones likes a certain kind of music. I hold their hands, assure them I'm here. I stroke their hair and talk to them. All of which feels lacking without family present. Limiting time with my patients feels so unnatural to me, but necessary to protect myself. My anxiety has skyrocketed. My mind is constantly running, dissecting every shift, each patient, every family interaction. All of this causes a visceral heaviness that makes you ache and keeps you awake at night. There is so much loss of control with COVID.
Self-isolation after work doesn't help.
I do have a wonderful support system. But most can't possibly understand what we're seeing and doing. Honestly, I'm too emotionally exhausted to try to explain it. My coworkers are incredible. We're leaning heavily on one another. We cry together. We're collectively grieving.
I'm so tired. Every day, we do our best. But this virus takes our patients one after another. We're doing everything we can think of, and inevitably they succumb. Then we step outside into the fading light and hear applause. The cheers ring out and the sirens blare. It's a celebration of the survivors. May we all continue to celebrate this survival. Continue to cheer for every day that we are alive.
Let's play a game. You're given 436,800 minutes, and what do? Do you go out and party with your friends? What about hopping on the latest trends? Here's what you should do. Go out with that guy, buy that dress, go on that adventure. It's okay to be a mess. I was too, but I'm here to say this. Just go out and be you. Before you know it, your 436,800 minutes are up, and it's time to move on. It's time to say goodbye to the people who were there for the endless laughing and crying and adventures, to the summer night drives with the music so loud you can't even hear each other singing, to the dance parties and movie nights, to the crazy stories and secrets shared. So, you have 436,800 minutes. Go.
Hi, FPAC seniors. My name is Shannon Thaler. I graduated with the class of 2017, so I know what an exciting time this is. First of all, a huge congratulations on all of your accomplishments thus far. And while nobody could have guessed that there would be a digital showcase this year, if anybody can make the best of a situation, I know for sure it's FPAC. So I wish you all the love and luck as you embark on your next journey, and don't forget to dream big and truly cherish these last moments as a senior.
Hey everybody, it's Cal Penn here. I just wanted to wish a huge congratulations to the entire FPAC class of 2020. You are all incredibly talented. Well, maybe not all, but like most of you clearly are very talented. No, I'm just kidding. You're all obviously talented. You're not just in the program, you're graduating from the program. I know there's a world of uncertainty out there, but at times like this, it seems like, you know, people rely on artists to be the storytellers that remind us of where we've been and where we're going. And that common humanity is something that each of you, I know, are going to capture and continue to capture in all of the careers and all of the places that you go once you leave FPAC. So congratulations and best of luck to all of you. I had to use this picture, sorry. Not sorry, bye.
FPAC class of 2020, congratulations. It was one of the highlights of my year, getting to come down and work with some of you. So thank you for having me. I really wish that I could be there in person right now, seeing your work and cheering you on and congratulating you on all of your accomplishments. I'm sure that the last few months have been frustrating and that this is not the way you imagined this would be going. All of the work that you've done in the last few years is yours forever. No one can ever take that from you. It's become a part of who you are. And so when you graduate here and you go forward, no matter what you decide to do with your life, you carry this work with you and it will inform everything you do. It's hard work and you worked hard to get here. So congratulations. I wanted to share something with you. I made a very obvious choice. It's from Letters to a Young Poet by Rainer Marie Rilke. Do you remember how that life yearned out of childhood toward the great thing? I see that it is now yearning forth beyond the great thing to the greater one. That is why it does not cease to be difficult. But that is also why it will not cease to grow. I'm going to be expecting big things from all of you, so keep up the hard work. Congratulations.
Thank you for watching our virtual showcase. Obviously, this is not the show we had planned to do, nor is it the show we wanted to do. The past few months have changed us and challenged us in many ways. I am proud to say, however, that it has not diminished the dedication of our staff or dampened the passion of our students. While this year's showcase cannot truly capture the talent of our students and staff, or their collaboration, or their professionalism, it certainly is a testament to their commitment to the arts and to their belief that the show must go on. I would like to take a moment to acknowledge our students for all the work they've done this year. It has not gone unnoticed. I'd also like to take a moment to acknowledge our phenomenal staff. Throughout this whole pandemic, they've done a wonderful job of transforming the performance-based classrooms into virtual classrooms. In the dance program, Ms. Arecki, Ms. Kramer. In our acting program, Mr. Kazakov and Ms. Myers. In our voice program, Ms. McAllen. And in our ET program, Mr. Napolitano and Mr. Gandolfo. Wonderful job to all of you. I'd like to give a special shout out to Mr. Napolitano for being our executive producer today and for navigating all the technology we're using to put this show together for you. I'd also like to acknowledge the Board of Education. In a time where funding and budgets continually become an issue for schools to face, they are steadfast in their support of our program. I'd finally like to thank you, the parents, for your support of our program and for your students' dreams. Now let's get on to the awards. A quick shout out to Ms. Alberts, who did a wonderful job once again of putting our certificates together. Student winners, just so you know, the awards will be given to you when you pick up your caps and gowns. And at this time, I'm going to introduce Ms. Myers from the acting program.
I have the privilege of awarding the Growth in Acting Award. When speaking with Mr. Kazakov, we were going over how many students from this class could really have earned this award. The young lady that we've decided to give this award to came into our program with an amazing amount of raw talent. And we've been so lucky and grateful to see how she has built upon that talent. Her ability to access natural and honest emotion, almost with the flip of a switch, is astounding. And it's been so nice to see it grow before our eyes. So without further ado, this year's winner for Growth in Acting is Isabella Rizzuto. And now I'm going to hand it off to Mr. Kazakov.
Hello, everybody, and welcome, seniors. This is exciting that you're all graduating. I'm sorry it's going like this, but I have no doubt you guys are going to go out and take the world by storm anyway. I am very excited about the things you will do in this life. It is my privilege and my honor to give the award tonight for accomplishment in acting. And that is also a very difficult award to give because so many of you have really, truly accomplished so much over the year. Not just the work you've done at the center in the classes, the work you've done in the drama club, the work you've done in other shows outside. You've all been really very, very busy and absolute role models because of the way you use your time and take advantage of the opportunities presented to you. It's my very great pleasure to present tonight the Accomplishment Award in Acting to Daniel Tramontana. Thank you, Daniel, for all your work, and congratulations. And now, it's my great pleasure to introduce Lisa Arecki.
Thank you, Mr. Kazakov. Hello, everyone. Now I'm going to start off by presenting the Growth and Dance Award. I am so proud of this dancer and all that she has accomplished. Her hard work and perseverance are remarkable and are the reasons I have seen such amazing growth and improvement in this dancer in the past 2 years. I'm so lucky to have been able to see her come out of her shell and truly shine the way she has. The Growth and Dance Award goes to Kayla Robertini. Next, I will present to you the Lisa Twomley Accomplishment in Dance Award. This next dancer is extremely talented and someone who shines not only on stage, but in the classroom as well. She is constantly noticed by her peers and teachers for her tremendous ability and superb performance. I am very excited to give the Lisa Twomley Award for Accomplishment in Dance to Taylor Dodd. Now, for the next set of awards, here is Miss Melanie Kramer.
Why, thank you, Mrs. Arecki. This next award is for Growth in Choreography. This dancer always was eager to explore new ways of moving. When it came time for a new task or an assignment, she always implemented all the choreographic tools and explored the unknown while developing her artistic voice. We are so excited to see how she will bring these gifts into her future of camp. And the award goes to Isabella Sessa. And the next award is for Accomplishment in Choreography. We are so excited to give this award to a dancer whose work has been selected numerous times for our choreography showcases. She has proven to be a great leader, sharing her versatility and depth of movement vocabulary, which always led to thought-provoking material. It has been such a pleasure observing her develop inventive material and artistry. And the award goes to Victoria Ho. And now we turn it over to Mr. Scott Napolitano.
Thank you. The first recipient of the Growth in Video Production Award goes to someone who has actively pushed themselves to learn new things as much as possible. This person has screened films and won awards for both live action and animated pieces. She actively volunteered to help upperclassmen while still an underclassman herself, then paid it forward as a junior and senior. No one is more supportive in their feedback. No one is more happy to help. Always smiling, always encouraging, exceptionally creative. The award goes to Sophie Genovese-Mester. The second recipient of the Growth in Video Production Award goes to a member of the senior class who quietly became one of the slickest editors around. Humble to a fault, he'd merely shrug off any compliments for his work. But it's no easy task to bring the apocalypse to Central Park, and he did it in 48 hours. Like a ninja, his projects appear on time, polished, striking, often unexpectedly funny and visually interesting. And like Sophie, he's always willing to volunteer and help out. This award goes to Ethan Rothschild. All right, next up, we have the first recipient of the Achievement in Video Production Award, which goes to a young lady who hit the ground running as an underclassman, getting her first acceptance at a film festival for work done early in her sophomore year. I told her to slow down. I told her to take a breath, to avoid juggling too many projects, lest she burn out. But sitting around not doing anything isn't really her style. And the result has been success after success. A talented young filmmaker, a leader in the school, and one of the hardest working filmmakers you're gonna meet. She'll next be attending DePaul University for film production. This award goes to Lulu Chua. And finally, I often post our videos and photos with the hashtag WeAreStorytellers, WeAreHowell. And the final recipient of one of the video awards, Achievement of Video Production, has embraced his role as one of our premier storytellers. He's one of the most dynamic young filmmakers I've been fortunate enough to see develop in my time in this program. From the absurd to the affecting, sci-fi, horror, comedy, you name it, he can do it, whether it's writing it down on the page or bringing it to life on the screen. I was pleased to learn of his commitment to the University of the Arts, where he'll be continuing to hone his filmmaking craft. This award goes to Sean Villa. Next up, Mr. Joe Quintana.
The first award I have for this evening is the award for growth in production. And the recipient for this award is someone who is a candidate for all four of the awards that I have for this evening. She could easily have won any of the awards, but her most outstanding achievement and accomplishment is her growth in the area of production. I don't think it was something that she came to FPAC for in the beginning, and as a freshman was one of the shyest students I've ever had, but has grown to be a leader and has learned so much about production. In addition to her supreme talent in music, the winner of this award this year is Miss Olivia Kulari. The next award is for accomplishment in production. And this also is an award going to someone who I don't think came into the program expecting that this would be her strong suit. And she also is a candidate for several of the awards this evening. But her ability to command the backstage area with authority and grace and sensitivity and empathy and drive all at the same time is unparalleled. And so this year, the award for accomplishment in production goes to Adanze Benjamin. Okay, now we're gonna move on to the awards for music. So first is the award for growth in music. This award goes to one of the most interesting students I've ever had, one of the most interesting people I've ever known. He has an unbelievable command of music history and music trivia, as well as pop culture in the United States. And it's inspiring to have a conversation with him, and also challenging to have a conversation with him, and always challenges me to do the best that I can for my students. His drive during the second semester of this year, up until we had to go home for the pandemic, was absolutely a clinic on professionalism and commitment to a passion project. And so this year's winner for growth in music goes to Mr. Tyler Partnow. And then last but not least, the award for accomplishment in music goes to a gentleman who is one of the most dedicated young composers the program has ever seen. He is unassuming and humble and quiet and soft-spoken, but if you put him in front of notation software or give him manuscript paper and a pencil, he will light up that score like a Christmas tree in all different styles of music, and it's going to be amazing to see what he does in the future. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the award for accomplishment in music goes to Mr. David Montgomery. Okay, I'd like to turn things over to Mrs. McGowan.
One thing that we look for in students is their enthusiasm to take advantage of all the opportunities that are offered here in our program. Both students that I'm going to speak about have a voracious appetite for music, for learning, and they've impressed me with their consistency and their passion. The recipient of the Vocal Growth Award is someone who has exhibited a tremendous work ethic in and out of the FPAC program. As a music student, she has an impeccable record and is meticulous about all her work. As a singer, you will have seen her in not only 4 years in a row of our Eva Voice recitals, but in community theater productions, the Howell musicals, Allstate Choir, and more. Her positive attitude and boundless effort have resulted in growth and sophistication with every performance. The award for vocal growth goes to Alexandra Slavkis. For her vocal accomplishment, this recipient has impressed me with her passion and mastery of an incredibly wide range of musical styles, from classical music to pop, from serious choir literature to rock, from being a gifted pianist and accompanist, and now a successful composer. She can do it all. She has already proven herself to be an accomplished musician, and I expect to see tremendous things from her in her future. This year's Vocal Accomplishment Award goes to Rachel Jafrida. And now back to our fearless leader, Mr. Chern.
So I am now honored to give out the last two awards, the department-wide awards. So the first one up is the Young Artist Award. Again, we are very fortunate in our department to have so many committed, talented, and just enthusiastic students in our program. This award recognizes a student who has that exceptional persistence and dedication and talent to the point where the department is very confident we're going to see this person in a career in the arts in the future. This year's winner has an undeniable artistry and creativity. Her teachers describe her as being very original, very tireless, dedicated, and just most importantly, just a very good person. It's my pleasure to announce this year's young artist as Miss Abby Kilty. The last award of the night is one that's very near and dear to everyone in this department. It's the Dan Green Legacy Award. Dan Green founded this program over 35 years ago based on his love of students, his pride in education, and his passion for the arts. Dan had a genuine love for Howell High School and FPAC and was very proud he was able to create a safe place for young artists to grow and learn. The Dan Green Legacy Award recognizes the student who most exemplifies the qualities Dan so admired and demonstrated. This year's winner clearly had these attributes and displayed them in such a genuine way that the entire faculty readily agreed upon the winner's worthiness. Actually, that's a lie, because there was a huge debate between two students whose selflessness and desire to improve not only themselves but the overall quality of our program was so visible that we finally gave up and relented and named two winners this year. It's my pleasure to announce this year's Dan Green Legacy Award winners. First, Ms. Zoe Morocco. And last but certainly not least, Mr. Mitchell Ritter. Congratulations. And on that note, we are successfully completing our virtual showcase with very few bruises. We miss everybody and hope to see you all soon. Thank you all.